two legends, one can, Jack and Coke. And this week, it was two legends, one can, one cup, because we got that victory, Pat.
We sure did. And it was like the dichotomy between Pop Watson and Anthony Calandria. You know, one guy who had unfortunately not been able to suit up and perform for the Hoos. And then we got this guy, Pop Watson, who, you know, albeit a I think we learned a lot about him last week versus Duke, but we learned a lot more about him this week. And what we didn't see down in Durham was the confidence and the energy and the swagger that, you know, our QB1 for our rivalry game, Pop Watson, did have. He was incredible. He was fun. He set the tone early. He delivered in the second half where we needed him. And ultimately, you know, he earned every bit of his chapter in the Virginia Tech, Virginia rivalry and Hokie lore, as I like to say.
No doubt about it. VT beat UVA for the 19th of 20 years. And that's what Sam said at the top of the show. It's our fourth straight victory, 24 of 26. And it never felt very close. Now, before we get to kind of the game breakdown, Pat, I thought you were going to the game. I thought you were at the game. There was some confusion on Twitter. Someone thought I was you, and then I thought you were in Blacksburg. Totally wrong. Tell us how you took in the game. Where were you? What were you doing?
Yeah, and I know it's been like this internal conflict between my ears the last week or so, but you know, decided not to go. Just again, the season caught up to me, and it's the first time I missed the Tech UVA game since 2011. But you know, albeit COVID, but I did consume the game at Shades of Green. If you have been to the Manhattan Hokies bar, it is in like Gramercy, like East Village area. And they do a really good job there. There were about 20, 30 Hokies there. And Dr. Lord Jeremy Counts happened to be one of the fellow patrons, which I just was blown away about. I was there with my girlfriend and her family. And we were just having, you know, we went out to dinner. And we were like, all right, let's check out Shades Green. Never been there before. All of a sudden, we're like midway through the first quarter. And I see, you know, this guy over here clearly animated in conversation wearing a Bruce Arians type hat. Like, is that who I think it is? And sure enough, it was Jeremy. And it was too funny running into him. Probably the last person I would have expected to see there. And I'm sure he wasn't sure what I was doing, not at the game either. But
he was a long way from home. A long way from home. If I saw Jeremy in Manhattan, it would blow my mind. So I can only imagine how you were feeling at that moment. Sam did go, which I'm very proud of you, Sam. You and your family are dedicated Hokies. We appreciate it. We got one of three on this show that went to the game. What was the experience like? How was the crowd?
So I will say this, like, I thought we came up a little bit later. Like, we didn't tailgate and stuff like that, just with Thanksgiving and the cold and stuff. So we just grabbed some food beforehand, parked, headed into the game. And the tailgate scene didn't look to be like what we thought it would be. But then you get in the game and that place was packed. It was rowdy. Like, from the get-go, it was, I'm shocked. I did not think it was going to be that packed of an atmosphere as it was. I got to tell you too, man, wasn't that bad with the cold. Was not that cold. It was chilly, but it wasn't as bad as
I feel like whenever you get into Lane, it's never quite as cold as the actual temperature.
No, like, I felt comfortable. Everyone around me felt comfortable, had a great time. It was just an unreal way to end the season. Like, it just felt so good to end it on that note in Lane Stadium. I think for a lot of people, this was kind of a last straw game. Like, I think if the team didn't perform Saturday night, I think you would have seen a lot of people kind of say, that's it. Like, I'm done for a little bit here until they figure things out. So from that side, it was a really, really big result and a big performance. Cause like you said, the game never looked close. Tech marched down the field on them and scored, got the ball back, marched down the field again, got a short field goal. Like, Virginia Tech was rolling in that game from the start, always looked like the better team. And like Pop Watson said, you could see it in UVA's eyes. Like, UVA didn't want to be there. They were cold. They were shivering. They weren't playing with a lot of energy. Their sideline did not have a lot of energy. I think the most excited that UVA got all game was when they thought they almost recovered a fumble.
Yeah.
That was it.
It got to 13 at one point. Again, it never felt like the Hokies were going to lose. We were up 20-3 at the half after the long lane touchdown, which was awesome. And then at the end of the game, Tootin adds the nail in the coffin, just the way it was a perfect ending and a perfect run, because like, it looks like he's bottled up. He runs to the end zone. Pat, that was so typical of Tootin and just a great way for his season to likely end.
I'm a dog and I'm coming. He said that last year during after the Pittsburgh game to Taylor Tannenbaum. And that was Pittsburgh. You know, that was very early in this group of players, right? You know, you had a lot of guys transfer in prior to last year, including Dacial Tootin. You know, Drones, Tootin, Felton, Jennings. You know, it was a ton of guys came in last year. And we saw what Dacial Tootin could be the second half of last year. And obviously, you know, this was his banner year in a Virginia Tech uniform. You know, over 1,000 yards on the year. I started losing count on touchdowns.
17
I
know he's total.
Seventeen total.
Tied for fifth all time from a position player.
Which is unbelievable. You know, I know Ryan Williams did like 24 or something.
He did like 30. Yeah, no, it was like 28, I think.
You know, I know that Tootin passed Ken Oxendine. I want to say he's eighth all time now in total touchdowns.
I think that's right. I know he passed Ken the other day in yardage, right? So
And he's at 29 total touchdowns with the Hokies in 2 years.
So, yeah. I mean, just such a blessing to be able to watch a guy like that who had a very similar Virginia Tech career to Khalil Herbert. You know, I think those are probably our best two backs over the last decade plus, really since David Wilson. And, you know, I think he just did it in the Dacial Tootin way, you know, a quiet confidence, a quiet swagger, whether it's, you know, busting out and just, you know, being a bowling ball that he is, or the classic, you know, slow down the engine as you approach the end zone to kind of give the guy a chance, even though he's never going to have a chance. That is the Dacial Tootin way to do it. Kind of psych out the those poor DBs every time.
He also did it on few carries. I know his yards per carry wasn't as high as Khalil's because Khalil has the record in that, but he had 18 carries when he broke the school rushing record. You know, like this guy can be a home run hitter. And if he had played behind a better offensive line, and I'm not trying to disrespect the offensive line, they got better. They were good at run blocking this year. We saw it. It's hard. You can't break the school rushing record unless your O-line can block pretty well. And so in the run game, they were solid. But if he had played at Ole Miss or Ohio State or one of these schools that has a big boy offensive line.
Georgia Tech.
Imagine what he could have. Georgia Tech had a great offensive line this year. Imagine what he could have done. And he still was incredible. And I loved watching him run. It's so similar to the Khalil Herbert because the seasons both years did not go the way we wanted. But every time they touched the ball, it was very fun.
Yeah, and if that's the last carry he has as a Hokie, dude, what a way to end it. Like a quintessential Dacial Tootin run. And although I will say, like, post-game, when he was sitting down for the post-game radio interviews, he was talking a whole lot about getting prepped for the bowl game.
He loves to play. Like, he's been playing through injuries all year long.
I don't know if I would advise him to play in the bowl game, but it wasn't a clear
option. Because he wants to play in the Senior Bowl too. So
wants to play in the Senior Bowl. Guy just loves football.
Yeah. Let's talk about the defense quickly, guys, because they were a huge reason that UVA was never in this game. We had 5 sacks, 3 from APR alone, 7 TFL, 2 interceptions, 5 pass breakups. Musket was barely over 50% completion, just 19 of 36, and only 3 yards a carry for UVA. It was a dominant performance, and one that, in this game, Pat, I felt like they kept things in front of them. Like, we did not give up the big play as we saw just the previous weekend.
Yeah, I think we really weren't going to allow Tony Musket to beat us, which is why I thought, too, you know, it must have been really bad with Anthony Calandria the last few weeks. You know, I haven't been watching that much UVA football this year, but you know, they did have five wins.
SMU blowout.
Yeah, they did have five wins coming in. And, you know, we have seen what AC-10, I think that's what they call him or used to call him, was capable of. But I really think that, one, containing Tony Musket, and two, the linebackers played great. And really, the front seven played great. I mean, when you have Caleb Woodson and Jaden Keller leading the team in tackles with 9 and 8 respectively, you're probably going to shut down their run game and make them one dimensional. And, you know, for the most part, that's what it was. You know, UVA had 274 total yards. You know, you had two turnovers, you know, Delane and Jalen Jones. Jalen Jones had a nice little interception return there as well. But really, you know, you mentioned it, Pete, you know, I think the defensive line set the tone, but it was a complete game by the front seven in general as well.
The Woodson and Keller point is great because those are two guys, Woodson being a younger guy, that just have come on so strong throughout the season and have improved week over week. Sam and I have talked a lot about them on this show and on Two Deep. It's really exciting for the future of the linebacker position. I think Keller's short on eligibility, but Woodson has a couple years left, and it's fun to think about what the possibilities are with him. Let's give a proper attention segment to Pop Watson here, because I think Pat mentioned it right as we started this, but like, he was the story of this game. 14 of 21 passing for 254, 48 rush yards, a 184 passer rating, and an 85.4 QBR, which, guys, is the highest of the season, whether it was Schley, whether it was Drones, the best QBR performance of the year. He really impressed me. What were your thoughts, Sam?
Shock. Like, did not expect that at all. I mean, that guy put on a hell of a performance, and he looked so comfortable. Most of his incompletions were either like missing a deep ball long or throwing the ball away when he needed to throw it away. I think he only missed two or three passes, and one of them was almost a great catch for a touchdown by Steven Gosnell. Really close to a great touchdown catch there. He was really good running the ball, ran for 65 yards, but didn't have a ton of designed runs, only a few. Great pocket mobility, always kept the ball up, ready to throw. That was maybe the most impressive thing for me, is how he moved in the pocket and kept his eyes downfield, wanting to throw the ball. Like, he looked, he looks like a quarterback that you didn't have to scheme everything for.
He's a natural, right?
Yeah. Looks so good. Pat's excited. I can tell Pat's excited.
It was just like, wow, we haven't seen something like this as far as from just a raw instinctive ability in a really long time, where ball's in his hands, 1, 2, 3, ball is out, or 1, 2, 3, he's tucking it and running. I just think he has that ingrained. And Dave Scaringella, I put this out there on our podcast earlier. I did think his article that he put out on X and also on his website, DallasDistrict.com, had some really good metaphors and described Pop as a point guard of the offense, where he was really in it to just make sure he's setting up others for success throughout the football game. And I also thought, like, when he decided to tuck it and run, it seemed like he was so well-intentioned with which way he was going and why. You know, Pop Watson, he's not Kyron Drones or Gerard Evans or Logan Thomas. You know, he's going to, if he puts himself in that position, he could take some serious licks. You know, he's not the biggest guy. So he has to be very much well-intentioned with when he decides to tuck it. And I thought every single time he was running the ball, it was making an impact on every single drive. But swagger, the confidence, first drive of the game, 11 plays, 90 yards, Pop Watson, like, let's go, young man. All the sellies, like, guy had it. He has swagger to him.
He has a certain it factor to him that we saw in his first spring game when he was playing, when he was, should have been going to his prom, as they always say at those spring games. Like, he popped on the film in his first spring game, and he is just kind of a natural QB who is it's one game and it's UVA and we need to keep that in mind, but like, he is a better natural passing quarterback than Drones. Like it's almost readily apparent after watching him just play in Duke and this game. Like Drones is a good overall quarterback. And when he's healthy and playing at his best, he was extremely effective for us last year and at points this year. But Pop as a throw over the football, and just if you, it's not just his stats from the UVA game, it's the processing, it's the quick decisions, as Pat alluded to. It's a very like, it's a Kyler Murray-esque movement pattern with Pop Watson. You know, that's very quick, it's shifty, it's getting out of bounds to avoid damage. It's that kind of thing. Whereas Drones, it's different than that, obviously. He's mowing people down and he's just as dangerous with his legs. But you can't, you know, with the UVA caveat, you can't come away anything else but impressed with how he played. And
so, something I want to point out about him, Sam, too, is so he had 20 pass attempts, right? Or 20 on those dropbacks, right? Over 10 yards per play when he threw the ball. Over 10 yards per play. When he ran the ball, he had 9 carries. Over 7 yards per play. So when he touched the ball and he was in control of it, Tech was moving the ball downfield and they were moving it in chunks. Still didn't have a lot of explosive plays from Virginia Tech. Only 3 explosive plays, obviously one being the Jalen Lane deep touchdown and the Bashal Tuten big ball. It was just so methodical, and it wasn't 4 yards in a cloud of dust. It was 6 yards, 7 yards, 8 yards, time and time again. Just looked really, really comfortable. And I also have to say, shout out, I thought our wide receivers had one of their best games of the year. Definitely. I thought Felton was like there were plays where he had 2 or 3 guys wide open. There were a couple plays where he could have chosen, do I throw to Jennings or do I throw to Felton? So I thought our wide receivers got open, played a really good game. I will caveat though, Virginia's probably the worst defense Tech has played since.
No more caveats. No.
since Old Dominion.
Yeah. It's a bad unit.
They're not a good defense. However,
was Sanker out there, by the way?
Yeah, he was out there.
That was like last year, he made an impact on the game, even though we beat them down. I didn't even notice him out there this past game.
I think Pop did a whole lot more than I think even the coaches thought he would do. Like Brent Pry, there was some genuine surprise, and he made the comment a couple times like, he didn't look like that in practice. He's a gamer. That's coach's nice way of saying I think he even said something like, yeah, he didn't look that fast in practice. We need to get on him during sprints and stuff like that.
He's got a little bit of Michael Brewer in him. He's got that gamer quality. And as Rich Luttenberger would be happy with, the zero turnovers. Zero turnovers for a guy making his first start in his redshirt freshman season, Pat. That's pretty impressive.
I mean, the whole turnover thing, our forced takeaways per game, 1.9 per game, which is good for 11th in the country. Now, the issue I have with that is that this is a 6-6 football team that's forcing, you know, 2 turnovers a game. And I know just our turnover ratio in general would not indicate that of a 6-6 ball club. So it's a bummer. But yeah, Sam, to your point, like the wide receivers, Jennings, Felton, Lane all had over 50 receiving yards. You know, I don't think that's happened all season. We finally hit on those deep balls. We hit Jennings pretty deep. We hit Felton deep finally. And then of course the Jay Lane sprinting towards the north end zone that we missed so much. I know we saw it a couple times last year. We did see it when he returned that punt versus Marshall, but I think everyone in Lane Stadium was missing that Jay Lane touchdown burst towards the student section.
I want to get to some takeaways, guys. And then at the end of these takeaways, I have a question involving Pop Watson that it's going to be interesting. But my first takeaway is just that Tony Elliott, as the coach of the Hoos, he might not have it. He just might not have it. I mean, it's the worst 3-year record of anyone in the power conferences through the last 3 years. He's 11-23. He came in at a pivotal point in the program. And then he did have, you know, the tragedy that happened, which kind of stunted a little bit of everything that was going on. And they improved a bit last year. And then we beat the absolute piss out of them at the end of the season. somehow they pick up the pieces from that, start 4-1, and they go into the tank again. It's not good over in Charlottesville. And the way he coaches, I said it in one of my videos I put out on Twitter, like, we give Pry shit for his body language and some of the stuff he does on the sidelines and just not winning enough games, but it's worse with Tony Elliott, Sam.
Yeah, and it's not the fact that they haven't been good, right? It's the fact that they've been bad. And I think that is, like, this is going to sound dumb, but, like, at a program like Virginia, you can have a not great record and still impress and still make progress. I don't think that they have made progress. Not only is it the lack of quarterback, which that has been, I mean, since they got on campus, quarterback's been a mess. Musket, Calandria, back and forth. Neither of them have been any good. That's why it's been an issue. But you also look defensively, they've been a train wreck. And that was the unit that they brought back, guys. They brought back Sanker in the secondary. They brought back a good amount of their defensive line. Guess what? They're 117th in the country in schedule adjusted EPA.
Yeah.
117th. There's only 130 something teams. It's the second worst defense Tech has played this season. They're not just not good, they're bad. And I don't know if with how their recruiting is going, their schedule's not going to really be getting that much easier.
Calandria just hopped into the portal. And Calandria
is gone.
Graduating. So actually, I'm drinking a beer. I'm not going to do a beer review just yet, but I'm drinking a beer in honor of Calandria. This is the Mad Elf.
I almost got that from the cellar. Like literally this close.
It's a phenomenal beer. I'll talk about it. But yeah, he's an angry elf today because he's bouncing out of Charlottesville. And it's hard to blame him. But I also don't think you have a better opportunity to like play in games than he would in Charlottesville. Like, yeah, he could go somewhere and get behind a better O-line because that has been a major issue for UVA.
Roster-wise, they look like the end of the Fuente year teams. When you look at guys, you're just like, you're fine, but you're probably not a big-time college football player.
That's what they got.
Virginia Tech looked so much faster than UVA. Yeah. So much faster.
And you know the struggles that we have. So that says
athletes,
a lot.
Athletes haven't been the struggle, Virginia Tech.
That's true. All right. So this season was rough for the Hokies, but it feels really nice to be 6-6 today and not 5-7 and not going to a bowl and losing to UVA. That would have been very toxic, Pat. The fan base was going through it like leading up to the game. And they're talking like, well, if it assures us of making substantial changes, then I'd be willing to perhaps lose this game. Was that your thought process going into this game? Or was it always like, no, this is a must win?
I wouldn't say I was black and white about it. I know some people were black and white about it, right? You know, I think going in and even just seeing the juice of some of the other games on rivalry weekend, you know, when you're watching Michigan try to plant the flag, I say try, they did succeed in planting the flag in Columbus, even though Gus Johnson had a tantrum about it.
And then they got maced.
They got maced. You know, after Georgia Tech, Georgia, Friday night. But I was never in the camp of, you know, I don't want to know what it's ever like to lose to them again. Like after 2019, like that day, how brutal that was. I was what, 4 years old in 1998? Like, I don't remember what happened back then. But this is table stakes. This is the standard. If we lose this game, things are going to get really bad. I just really hope that there is enough introspection from this staff, from this athletic department, to take a deep look inside and in the mirror and say, hey, listen, this team was favored in 10 out of 12 games and only won 6. That is a huge problem. Or, hey, this team was supposed to win at least 8.5 games, according to Vegas, and here we are fighting for a bowl game versus Virginia, who, let's be honest, sucks and has sucked and probably will always suck. So, you know, to lose to that.
Well, Pete, said.
To lose to that, Pete, means you need to be, you need to just raise your hand and say, I want to be down bad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I could never will myself to say, hey, if it's good for the long term, we can lose to Virginia, because I just, I don't really want to know what that level of down bad feels like. But I truly, truly hope that this staff and this athletic department have what it takes to say, hey, we want to be serious about football at Virginia Tech. And I would say, hey, listen, whether you're in the BOV, whether you're Sands, whether you're Witt, whether you're Brent Pry, look at 8.01 p.m. on Friday night on ACC Network when they pan to that full freaking stadium on ACC Network, despite the carnage that was behind us from the previous 11 weeks. You have to deliver for these people because there's just too much
what our fans continue to do. It's pure insanity, honestly, mm-hmm. with the results they've been given, the constant porridge we're served for Thanksgiving dinner every season. It's amazing that they show up in a freezing cold game to a team that's massively underachieved. And I appreciate each and every one of you, including you, Sam, for being there because it's what makes our fan base great. I really wanted to go. I didn't go because it was going to take me 11 hours to get home on Sunday because Thanksgiving's, it's just a tough weekend for UVA. But I wanted to be there because the idea that losing this game could be better long-term, it's just one, there's no reason to believe it's true because you could easily lose, hire a new coach, that guy still sucks, and then you're still 5-7 for that season on the record books forever. No, this is 19-20. This is 24-26. This is 4 in a row. This is going to a bowl. Like, this matters big time, and I am so grateful that we were able to win and win easily because even the UVA fans in this rivalry on Twitter, they were hating life on Saturday night, and they're used to it. They are used to it every year, and they are so upset and hating everything. We got multiple Twitter accounts saying, like, I'm just done. I'm done with this school until they do something else. That's what they were doing. If we lose the game as the team that usually wins, I can't even imagine what it would have been like. So, yes, this was necessary, and I am so grateful that Pop and the boys did it. It was a great win. It really was.
Pop and the boys sounds like a really, like, sick R&B group from 1996. I got to tell you too, with the fan support, I remember, you know, texting two of my former coworkers who are big college football. One of them went to Georgia, one went to Oklahoma. And I sent them the video that I sent y'all of the entrance post jumping up and down.
It's on our video Instagram again. Page. Yes.
And I was like, this is a 5-6 football team in 22 degree weather. Like it is mind-boggling. It is such a special place. And I think if anything, it's push to strive for greatness more. And I think there's been this strive for slightly above average for, I would say, over a decade now, where it has became, hey, you compete in the ACC, you keep the bowl streak alive, you beat UVA, and it's job well done. And I think this the way the fan base has acted through the past few losing seasons, to me, it almost is just more of a incentive to really strive to be a top football program, not only in the ACC, but to get back to being a top 20, top 15 program in the country. And I'm just really impressed with how the Hokies came out. We'll see what the bowl game looks like. I don't really count bowl games for anything these days, nor do I think you really should. Especially when you play them at baseball stadiums in 30 degree weather for some reason.
How many teams in the ACC could have filled that stadium 5-6 at this weekend of the year? Clemson, maybe?
Maybe. I mean, but Clemson's a lot of, and no hate to the Clemson Tigers, but that's a lot of like new money fans. They weren't like that before Dabo.
I can't.
They had some bad years. I'm just saying, like,
there are very few, if any, teams in the ACC that after a 5-6 season could fill that stadium like that. It was impressive. That's all I want to say.
I mean, it's like us, Nebraska, Texas A&M.
Yeah,
are kind of the only,
and they're not in the ACC.
ones that would be the ones that would be that dedicated.
Yeah, maybe that. Notre Dame. Like we were there November 19th, 2016, 4-8 season, and that was a sellout.
It was full. It South was full. Bend. Yeah.
And I don't want anybody saying that Blacksburg was cold on Saturday night unless you were at that 2016 Notre Dame game,
which was,
and it was the worst weather cold I have ever sat through in my life.
Yeah. Billy just said the answer may be 0.5% of college football.
You can count the programs on your hand.
Yeah. All right. I have a question about our team for you guys. Will both Drones and Pop Watson be on the roster next season, Pat?
Probably not, but I don't know. I have no idea. I mean, here's the thing. Like, I don't know what numbers were thrown around from an NIL standpoint, but I know that we're going to take a hard look about what this roster was, and we're going to take a hard look at 2025 and see which levers need to be pulled in other directions. Because, you know, I think I don't know what was going on with Drones this year. You know, from what we saw from Pop on Saturday, we didn't see from Drones really once the entire season. We did see some of that in 2023 down the stretch, but extremely different quarterbacks here. I do think we are going to need to have, if it's not Drones, another option. If it is Drones, great. We have two quarterbacks and we'll have a controversy. But
your assumption, though, is what you're saying is Pop is back.
I think Pop is back.
It's been 1.5 games. I mean, We assume that he'll be back.
Yeah, to Billy's point, Completely agree. If one of them were to leave, you absolutely would need to portal someone in. You know, this team really needed Colin Schley this year. I'm really
James
glad
is bringing
Colin
the heat with this one.
I almost posted that.
Which QB gives us the best chance to beat South Carolina in game one next season?
Well, instead of echoing what Pat just said, because that it's not the answer people want to hear, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, this is such a back office conversation now that it goes beyond just what you see on the football field. I will say, though, with how Virginia Tech's offense has ran under Bowen, in 3 years, they have not been able to have an offense that succeeds without scheming guys wide open. They just have not been able to do it in any game against any opponent. Doesn't matter if it's Old Dominion or doesn't matter if it's Clemson. They just can't do it.
So you're saying that the quarterback needs to throw them open.
Some of the plays Pop made against UVA, and I know it's UVA, but some of those plays we hadn't seen anybody do in Tyler Bowen's offense yet. And if you're going up against a South Carolina team that's probably going to be pretty darn good next year, especially defensively, you're going to need a guy who can just make something out of nothing. And I think Pop's proven to be that guy. I will say, though, there's a reason Kyren Drones got the bag that he did and was QB1.
Yeah.
Like, he's done some pretty impressive things, and we have pretty good reason to believe that he's been beat up for a vast majority of this season. So I think writing off Kyren Drones is a pretty big mistake.
It is.
However, you know, We'll see.
And Billy makes a good point that Pop was one of the first Virginia Tech quarterbacks to expose the middle of the field in all season in a while. And like, he's a better passer. Like, I feel comfortable saying that, but Drones has an ability to break down the defense when fully healthy and when utilized properly. That's extremely dangerous. And so I don't know who's better, but to answer my own question, I don't think both are going to be on the roster next year.
No, probably not.
So we won't have to decide.
I will say, if there's one thing that you can pull from any bowl game Tech plays, and it'll probably be against a better defense than UVA, depending on opt-outs and stuff like that, is if he makes plays like that again. If he moves in the pocket like that. If he runs with, like Pat said, with real decision-making. That will be a telltale sign, other than just one game he played out of his mind. Because in that Duke game, and I know he was coming off the bench and cold and whatever, he missed a lot of throws that he should have made, that you need your quarterback to make. And like, he was 14 of 26, something like that. Wasn't great. Missed 21. A couple throws.
14 to 21.
Yeah, took some sacks. Like, we need to see more than one game from Pop. And they're going to need to see good winter workouts and good spring ball and a good fall camp before they call him QB1, I think.
Do you think the young guys on the team have definitely embraced Pop from this small sample size?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I did see, I forget who it was. I don't know if it was Reddish or Woodson, but guys were tweeting Pop Watson. So it's not like there's no shortage of camaraderie between.
It was very much, Pat, guys. Like, remember when Hendon Hooker got the start for the first time? And I think Trey tweeted about it or Instagrammed about it. A couple others did. It feels a little like that. Like there's a certain amount of groundswell within the locker room of like, hey, we've been seeing this guy. He can play a little bit. Let's give him a shot. And Pop is not short on confidence. And that bleeds into other guys sometimes. I'm not saying that Drones isn't. I think Drones is kind of more of a quiet confident.
Ooh. Billy Ray, which Hall of Fame are you talking about?
APR or Tootin have a chance at the Hall of Fame. I'm assuming he means the Virginia Tech Hall of Fame.
I hope so.
they do. I mean, I just don't think either have played long enough to get there at Tech.
This is the best defensive end season that Tech has had.
It's pretty darn good. It's pretty darn good. Yeah.
Here's the tough thing about the Hall of Fame. The Hall of Fame is what the best kept secret in Virginia Tech, as far as like, how do you get in? What do you need to do to be inducted? You know, it took Tyrod until what this year to get in the Hall of Fame.
It ain't easy. It's not going to happen for a while if it does happen, but 16 sacks in a season, tied for second in the country. It's pretty impressive. It's very, very impressive.
Yeah. I think right now APR probably has a better chance than Tootin, just based on, I don't know, like Darren Evans is not in the Hall of Fame, and Darren Evans held the previous record of 253 yards in a game against Maryland in 2008. 2008 was his redshirt freshman season. I think he ran for 1,200 yards in 2008. That's probably very similar to where Tootin is. Again, yeah, if Tootin was a 3-4 year guy, I think this is a different conversation. Like, you know, is David Wilson going to be a Hall of Famer one day? Not sure. I just know the criteria, which just seems so unclear. I have no idea if either of them will get in.
I think for Tootin, he didn't break any specific record. Like David Wilson holds the single season rushing record. Like if anyone should get it, it should be him. Now I know Tootin broke the single game, but that's not, you can't get in from one game. You know, Mike Emo had the record, I think, for a minute for a game. It's just that he didn't break the yards per carry record. He didn't break the single season rushing record. And he probably could have if utilized more at the beginning of the year, if he had full health and, you know, whatever. But I think APR has a better chance, I think, in my head.
Yeah. I also think, and it sucks for these two because they're individuals, but at the end of the day, like these two teams from the last 2 years didn't do anything.
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily call the 2023 and 2024 Virginia Tech Hokies a memorable
season. That hurts the case for sure. It's like the Heisman, right? If you go 6-6, you're not winning the Heisman. Like now with Colorado, you're allowed to go 9-3 and maybe win the Heisman, but you can't go 6-6.
Hey, didn't Tim Tebow win at like 9 and wasn't he 9-4 in
just last year? What was LSU?
Well, like, Lamar Jackson was like a 9-win team, right?
Yeah, that's fine. I'm just saying, like, once you get to a certain point, like you just can't, because there's a certain amount of like good stats, bad team that happens. But anyway, all right, that's all I have for the takeaways. Pat, if we play in the Fenway Bowl, I know your counterpart will probably be at the game. Would you attend a Fenway Bowl this year if Tech was in it?
Love the question. We know Billy Ray. If you know anything about Billy Ray, you know how much he loves Boston. You know, every single time Boston comes up, Billy Ray says, well, I love Boston. I am in a bit of a conflict, a good problem to have. But my parents did just, or they will be closing on a home in Blacksburg that weekend. So I'm thinking the move is going to be to help with the move, help kind of transition, get furnished, you know, everything furnished and set up, and then watch the bowl game from Blacksburg if that happens to be the case.
Is there any bowl location that of the ones that are possible for the Hokies that you would be like, I'm going?
This year?
Like Gasparilla. I guess if it was, do we have a chance to play in the Belk Bowl? I don't know if we're good enough for that.
Technically, Tech is not,
the Mayo Bowl. I'm sorry.
Option for Mayo Bowl in Charlotte, the Fenway Bowl, the Pinstripe Bowl, and the Gasparilla Bowl.
Yeah.
Only one of those is a destination I would really like to go to in late December.
And I did see a projection for the Armed Forces Bowl.
Wow.
In TCU Stadium. That's in Dallas.
Gosh. And I've always dreamed about vacationing in Fort Worth, actually.
They had us playing West Virginia in
That's gross.
Amon-Ra Stadium or whatever it is. Amon-G Stadium. But yeah, we're probably not going to do that. Anyway, this has been a good segment of ET Corner. Pat, I think we got to cut it off because we got to do some playoff predictions and some other stuff before we sign off. But thank you for joining us tonight, dude.
It's always a pleasure. You guys do an incredible job, and I always have fun when I pop on. So we'll have to run this back. I know we were thinking of doing some basketball this year as well, so it should be a good time.
Well, we're doing a live stream of the Vanderbilt game on Wednesday night. That's part of the other reason that we're moving too deep to Thursday. So I don't know if Pat will be there, but we're going to have Ed in the house. Sam will be here. And whoever else wants to join from the Sons of Saturday on Wednesday night for basketball. But Pat, we did this 2 years in a row, two Commonwealth Cups in a row. You came on CFB Monday and it's much appreciated.
Yeah. This time next year?
Yeah, let's do it again.
I'm in. Let's do it. Always a pleasure, fellas.
All right. See you, buddy.